Welcome to worship this morning. I'm Pastor Emily, and it's good to be with those of you joining us online and in person this morning. First of all, I would love to thank all of those who made the women's lunch possible on Monday. We had a wonderful time. Linda Freud led us in some devotions that were Psalms of Thanksgiving, and it was a wonderful luncheon together. We're having our next one on Monday, December 5th, and it's going to be Christmas-themed. So if you'd like to join, please mark your calendars. We'd love to see you there. Our Thanksgiving dedication service and feast is also coming up very soon. It'll be on Sunday, November 20th, and the feast will follow worship. We are looking for volunteers. So if you would like to help with setup or serving or cleanup, please contact the church office, and we'd love to get your name down on the list so we know how to plan. Pastor Jim, would you like to make an announcement about John?
If you look at your bulletins, there's some information about our next JOG speaker. He's really spoken at many different universities around the country, including Harvard and Stanford. But he's very articulate, and I think he's got a good story to share, and I hope you can join us. It's always a good time of fellowship, and I hope to see you there.
At this time, let's open with a word of prayer. God, we thank you so much for this beautiful morning to come together and to worship you. We think of all the churches and people who are gathering today to sing praise and thanksgiving to God, to you, our Creator. We thank you for the sound of flowing water, for birds in the trees, for greenery and sunshine. God, this morning we also think of those who are hurting. We pray for those who are lonely, who are grieving, who are sick or searching for answers. We pray that the comfort of your Holy Spirit would be very near to them. We pray that your Spirit would move and inspire each one of us so that we would know how to reach out and to love those around us who need to encounter you through humans who are led by you. God, we pray that your Spirit would move in our worship this morning. May our hearts sing praises. May you pour wisdom into our souls. And may we have a sense that you are very alive and near. We pray all this in Jesus' name. Amen. At this time, I invite you to stand and to join together in worship as Pastor Gretel leads us.
Thank you. name, Jesus Christ, my King. What a beautiful name it is. Nothing compares to this. What a beautiful name it is. The name of Jesus. You didn't want heaven without us. So Jesus, you brought heaven down. My sin was great, your love was greater. What could separate us now? What a wonderful name it is. What a wonderful name it is. The name of Jesus Christ, my King. What a wonderful name it is. Nothing compares to this. What a wonderful name it is. The name of Jesus. Death could not hold you. The veil torn before you. You silenced the boast of sin and grave. The heavens are roaring. The praise of your glory. For you are raised to life again. We have no rival. You have no equal. Now and forever, God who reigns. Yours is the kingdom. Yours is the glory. Yours is the name. What a powerful name it is. What a powerful name it is. The name of Jesus Christ, my King. What a powerful name it is. Nothing compares to this. What a powerful name it is. The name of Jesus.
Be seated. Our scripture reading this morning is from John 5, verses 1 through 9. Sometime later, Jesus went up to Jerusalem for one of the Jewish festivals. Now there is in Jerusalem, near the Sheep Gate, a pool, which in Aramaic is called Bethesda, and which is surrounded by five covered colonnades. Here, a great number of disabled people used to lie, the blind, the lame, the paralyzed. One who was there had been an invalid for 38 years. When Jesus saw him lying there and learned that he had been in this condition for a long time, he asked him, "Do you want to get well?" "Sir," the invalid replied, "I have no one to help me get into the pool when the water is stirred. While I am trying to get in, someone else goes down ahead of me." Then Jesus said to him, "Get up, pick up your mat, and walk." At once the man was cured. He picked up his mat and walked. The day on which this took place was a Sabbath. May God bless us in our hearing of his word this morning. And at this time, there you are, Terry. We'll invite Terry to come forward and share with us. She has been here for many, many years, and this is her last Sunday before the family moves to Las Vegas. We wanted to hear a word from her this morning.
Good morning. My family and I started coming here in 1995. And I was a single mom with two daughters. I had one daughter in elementary school and one in junior high. She wants me to be louder. And I hadn't been going to church for years before that, but I've really found a home here, and I found Christ again here at FCCA, and this is my church family. I'm going to miss all of you. I have been missing all of you since we decided 2 years ago. We came up with this plan. Actually, it was my oldest daughter, Jenny. She's a music teacher. And she went through all those years of school, and she found it difficult to make a living here in California as a music teacher. I mean, she put her best foot forward for years. She just couldn't get enough hours, enough classes, you know. And then when COVID hit, it really just knocked her out of her job, basically. So she had planned a trip on vacation to Las Vegas with a friend. And then when she came back, she had this plan, because she had also been hearing from the families that were leaving her. She taught school in Tustin, and a lot of families were just leaving because when COVID hit, they lost their job. And a lot of them were going to Las Vegas, and there's a teacher shortage in Las Vegas still. So she came up with the plan that she wanted to go to Las Vegas. And for years, I had been wondering how I was going to retire. I had a mortgage, and I have disabilities. I have nerve damage in my leg. I was past due for retirement for a while, and I just really couldn't afford to retire here in California. So after talking to her for a while and kind of looking at the housing market and other things, I decided that it was time for me to retire, and I could sell and move to Las Vegas as well. And then shortly after that, my parents, who have been living in Santa Ana for 60-some years, so we moved here in 1964, actually, and they've decided to throw in with us, and we're all, we're combining our resources, and we're going to live together in Las Vegas. Their house and our new house is in escrow right now as we speak. So we went over there all together. It's been a precious time moving back with my parents and working all this out together. It's a precious time with them. And we found the Lord led us to just this beautiful house in Las Vegas that was within our needs and within our means. And we're just so excited about that, but very sad to leave all of you. My heart is breaking. Through whatever I was going through, Christ was always there for me to get us to this point. And I would just come to church sometimes with all this burden on the job or parenting, and I just found Christ here. It was easy for me to get connection with Christ here at this church, and I'm looking forward to finding another church home. But I know it will never be the same as this one. And, thank you all, and Pastor Jim and Penny and Emily and Tyler. We really miss singing for the choir. It's been 2 years since we got to sing up here, but I was just telling Pastor Jim I'm a little nervous. I haven't been on stage for 2 years, you know? But we just love you all. And, you know, you can visit us. We have our address, and after church, we could show you pictures of our new place. Thank you.
Terry, we're going to miss you guys a lot. And I remember when you guys first started coming, and the kids were young then, and to see what God's done in your life has been amazing. And I want to thank you for serving on the church council and for in the area of worship, and then also being in the choir all those years. And, of course, Jennifer also was head of VBS and so many things. And we're just so thankful for you guys. Let's just have a word of prayer together. Eternal God, I thank you so much for the people you bring into our life for a season. And I just pray, Lord, for Terry and her family, for the Honeckers, and just everybody, that you just really bless them in this new adventure of theirs. We pray that you give them a, just a good church home when they moved there to Vegas. Thank you, Lord, for your provision. Thank you for being by their sides through this whole time, this new journey that they're embarking on. We just ask that you bless them richly, and we pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen. All right, Tyler. Thank you, Tyler, so much. Also, I wanted to let you know we have a cake following the service in the library to celebrate with Terry and family. And also, I wanted to wish David Hill's birthday and Penny's birthday, too. Penny would be here, but her knee's still pretty swollen and can't quite make it yet. She really wanted to be here. But hopefully soon she'll be able to come back to church. It's amazing how you can be 29 so many years in a row, you know. But happy birthday, sweetheart. Last week we started our series entitled Questions That Can Alter Your Life. And I want to kind of review a little bit from last week as we start today. We want to talk about being made whole. It's been said that if you ask the wrong questions, you'll get the wrong answers. But if you ask the right questions, you're liable to get the right answers. There's really an art to asking thoughtful questions, because a good question causes us to contemplate our answers. A well-thought-through question leads to revelation. It leads to truth-speaking. It leads to knowledge and to wisdom. A thoughtful question leads the answer giver to expand on her thoughts, opinions, and knowledge. I shared with you last week when Penny and I were going to buy our first car together, I asked my dad if he would loan us the money, if we could go through his credit union, because he had much better rates at the credit union than at the local bank that we weren't a member of a credit union yet. And My dad said, sure, I'll lend you the money, but I just have one question. Can you afford it? Good question. Can you afford it? And that kind of crystallized our thinking. We realized as we kind of crunched the numbers that we couldn't afford it at that time. We had to wait a while and get a much bigger down payment. But, you know, questions can make us reevaluate our lives in so many different ways. And God asks great, thoughtful questions throughout the scriptures, which causes the hearers to ponder the answers for their own benefits and growth. He asks Isaiah, who will go for us? He asks Adam and Eve, where are you? That's what we looked at last week. He asks Moses, what's that in your hand? He asks Cain, where's your brother? He asks the disciples, why are you so afraid? He asks his followers, who do you say that I am? We'll be exploring these questions in the weeks ahead because they cause us to pause and contemplate our own lives. Who will go for us? Perhaps we should go. Maybe God's calling us to do something. Where are you? Where are we? That's a good question. Are we hiding from God or others or even ourselves? Why are we so afraid at times? What causes fear in our lives? Does that fear paralyze us from doing what God is calling us to do? These powerful questions, if honestly answered, will alter our lives. They get down to the nitty-gritty of living. Today, I want us to think about the question, do you want to be made whole? Some translations read, do you want to be healed? Now, most of us, at one time or another, have felt sorry for ourselves. Wouldn't you agree? We've had our own pity parties. You know, we complain that life's not fair. Maybe you were promised a promotion at work, but at the last moment, your boss passed over you and promoted one of your less deserving colleagues. Or perhaps your children didn't turn out the way you hoped they would, where your neighbor's children are excelling, even though you didn't think they were very good parents. Or maybe you were dealt a poor hand genetically. Even though you exercise and watch what you eat, your body produces high levels of cholesterol, just like your parents and grandparents before you. So you feel sorry for yourself, and it keeps you from being made whole. In today's scripture reading, we learn about a man who felt sorry for himself, but one day Jesus crashed his self-imposed pity party and encouraged him to change. He gave him new hope and restored him to wholeness. The question Jesus asked was, do you want to be made whole? Or do you want to be healed? You know, I have a good friend who likes to restore things. He restores clocks. He restores cars. He restores furniture, so many things. And one day he purchased this old Volvo, kind of a rare Volvo. And I thought, why would he buy something like that? It looked like a piece of junk to me. But he really got into restoring this old Volvo. And he spent lots of money on it. He got the finest leather from Italy. He had it reupholstered. The dash was made right. The engine was redone and rebuilt. It had a wonderful paint job on it. And it ended up taking first place in a car show because of all its diligence. I remember years ago, we were visiting Penny's parents, and her parents had this piece of furniture they wanted to throw out. It was a beautiful piece of furniture. I mean, I saw the potential in it. It was splintered and all on the top. But I thought, I wonder if it can be restored. So I asked them if we could have it, being they were throwing it out anyway. They said, sure. It was Penny's great aunt's. So I took it to Wally Haas. Wally Haas at that time was restoring furniture. And he made it just a showpiece. It was beautiful. In fact, we still have it in our home. As you walk in, that's the first piece of furniture you see. It was amazing what Wally could do. But restoring antique clocks or cars or houses or furniture takes a lot of time and effort, but the results sometimes can be well worth it. Things we think sometimes could be thrown away end up being restored and can look like new. This subject of restoration reminds me of today's scripture reading. It's a story about a man who had been limping around for a long, long time, feeling sorry for himself. For 38 years, that's close to 14,000 days, he had been lame as he lay beside the pool of Bethesda in the ancient city of Jerusalem. Now, this pool was thought to possess special healing powers at particular times when the water would begin to bubble up from the underground pressures. Many people at that time believed that an angel stirred up the waters, and if you happened to be one of the lucky people to get in there, that a miracle would occur and you would be healed and restored. You would be made whole. This pool of Bethesda has five porticos, which was rediscovered by archaeologists in 1871. In fact, you can visit it there today if you go to the ancient city of Jerusalem. It's not very large. It's not very impressive. Penny and I were there years ago, and we've seen it. But it was very important to the people at that time because of its curative powers. Even today, there are famous natural spas throughout the world where people can go to be restored and be rejuvenated and to be made whole. Can you picture in your mind's eye all these people gathered around this pool, the sick and the crippled, those who are hoping that they could get in and be cured? The hope of restoration. You know, I'm so thankful there are places today where we can be restored, aren't you? I'm not thinking of the spas and mineral springs, but of the organizations and institutions that are set up to help us when we are feeling spent emotionally or physically. Aren't you glad that there are hospitals and retreat centers and camps and clinics and psychiatric hospitals and vacation spots and churches where we can go to be restored? This past Friday, I was playing tennis with a guy that I just recently met, and I got cleaned. He cleaned my clock pretty good. He was quite a tennis player. And afterwards, we sat and talked for quite a while. And he was saying to me that 10 years ago, he owns a business and wasn't feeling very good. He felt spent physically, and he could barely walk. And he goes to his doctor. They ran a series of tests, and eventually it was discovered that his body was full of leukemia. He had cancer. And he said it changed his life. I would guess at that time he was probably in his late 30s. Anyway, he goes to the hospital. He took him down at Hoag Hospital, and he said he just packed his clothes, and he was there for 31 straight days. And it was just awful. He felt so weak, and you know, his bowels weren't working properly, and he'd get these chills and this fever, and it was just such a tough time. And he said, you know, those nurses and orderlies and doctors were like angels to me. They gave me hope. They really helped me so much. And he said, after I got done with all these treatments, I remember they wheeled me out of Hoag Hospital, and the sky never seemed so blue to me. It was just resilient with colors. It was so pretty. It was amazing. And he said, I looked down. I saw these flowers. They smelled so fragrant. And he said, even the weeds there looked nice. But he said, I look at life differently now. I really do. And he said, recently I just went to my oncologist again, and it's been 10 years, and I'm cancer-free. And I thought, what a beautiful story of being restored. Isn't that a good story? He was just so appreciative. He looks at life differently. And you know, people who have been through cancer or have had different ailments or maybe a severe car accident or whatever, and they come through it, they seem to look at life a lot differently. They seem to be more grateful and more in tune with living. If you ever get a chance to go to Val Yermo, it's a retreat center out in the desert run by the Benedictine monks. And you go there, it's about 600 acres, and no one speaks. You can only speak at dinner time. That's the only time. So you're there in silence. And it's in a kind of a high desert air near Pear Blossom, and it's so beautiful. But it's, sometimes it's in those quiet places that God gets our attention. You know, sometimes we rush around so much here and there, speeding here and there, with carrying lots of responsibility and putting ourselves under unnecessary stress. No wonder we find ourselves here in America with suffering from ulcers and high blood pressure and heart disease, because life can get tough. Sometimes we can crack under the pressure, and we find ourselves limping along, throwing ourselves a pity party. And then we go to a place of rest and relaxation. Thank God that there are such places where we can go and be restored and renewed. So thankful for those places. I hope our church is a place like that, where people can come in and be restored. Sometimes we know a good rest would do us good, but sometimes we're so tired we don't have the energy to even rest. We don't have the energy to join a group, maybe a grief group, because it just seems like too much energy to even join a group. But we know it would be good for us in the long run. Sometimes we are so tired we don't have the energy to do what in the long run would be in our best interest. I've known some fine people over the years who, through a series of calamities, have been unable to cope with the pressures of life. And after being worn down physically and emotionally and spiritually and mentally, they just collapse. Sometimes they have to be taken to a hospital or a psychiatric ward for a time of rest. One lady put it this way. She said, "I felt as if I was out in a swift-moving river, and the current was carrying me toward the falls. I kept waiting to go over the edge, and there was absolutely nothing I could do about it. I felt completely helpless." Have you ever felt like that? We've all had times like that, I think. And that's how it was, I believe, for the lame man in today's scripture reading. Can you imagine what it was like for him? He gets ready to go into the pool, and someone beats him there. He gets in and gets cured. And this went on for 38 years, 38 miserable years. He was dependent upon others because his legs were crippled. He probably had to beg for a living just in order to survive. For 38 years, he wasn't able to walk or to dance at his friends' weddings. I wonder after a while if he had many friends at all. Maybe he had become bitter with life. "Why me, God? Why was I born this way?" Picture in your mind's eye what it was like for him, trying to get in. And Jesus finds him kind of drowning in self-pity because he had lost all hope. If the Jerusalem County Register did a feature story on him, I wonder what he would have said. After 38 years of laying around a pool, he probably had some good stories to tell. Perhaps there were people there who had been healed early on, and now maybe they were sending their grandchildren to be healed there as well. I wonder if there were tourists who would gather around at that place just out of curiosity to gawk and watch to see what's happening. This poor man was stuck laying beside the pool for 38 long years, hoping that someday he would be restored and healed. Can you identify with him? And then all of a sudden, Jesus comes along, the healer, this itinerant preacher, this miracle worker from Galilee. "Do you want to be healed? Do you want to be made whole?" What a question. Doesn't everybody who's stuck in some kind of disease or crippling or crippled or whatever want to be whole? Not necessarily. Some people don't want to be made whole, at least emotionally. In fact, some people use their illness as an excuse to keep them from taking responsibility. I know a lady who's very, very bright. She graduated from college. She's physically in good health, and until she doesn't get her way. And then she says she's not feeling well, and she's used this. I've known this woman for, oh gosh, probably 40 years. And when she uses this illness to manipulate her family, her husband and her kids, Because when mama's not happy, no one's happy. And she goes from one doctor to the next because she doesn't like hearing what they have to say. She uses it to manipulate. When she doesn't get her way, all of a sudden she gets sick. But when she does get her way, she miraculously gets better. Boy, it's amazing how she gets cured so quickly. Have you ever noticed that some people have a chip on their shoulders? They always see the negative side of life. They concentrate on the thorns rather than on the roses. They become self-absorbed and unwilling to break out of their shells for fear of being rejected or condemned. Jesus, I don't have anyone to help me get out of the pool. I've been stuck here for a long time. That's how it's been my whole life. Everybody else ends up healed, but not me. You know, I think about the children of Israel, how they kept going around the mountain for 40 long years. They wandered in the wilderness, and then the Lord said in Deuteronomy 2:2, "You have made your way around this hill country long enough. Now turn north. You don't have to go around the mountain again. Make a change. Go north." You know, insanity has been described as doing the same thing over and over again, expecting different results. Sometimes in life, we need to make a change. One thing is for sure, life is full of change, isn't it? We can't stop it, can we? Can't stop the aging process. You can't change a lot of things. And sometimes we're afraid of change and repeat destructive habits. That was the case in today's scripture reading. And Jesus says to the paralytic, "Get up, take up your mat and walk." And just like that, he did. The scripture tells us that he was healed. I wish life was always that easy, don't you? That we just snap our fingers and be healed? But often it isn't that way, is it? I think of some people who have plenty of money in the bank, but they might even own their own bank, but they are still starving to death inside. They worry too much. Or some people have a comfortable bed to sleep in at night, but they can't sleep. They toss and turn all night because there's anxiety in their life. Some people have terrible physical pain to deal with. Let's face it, life can be hard at times. But the good news is, when we simply can't make it anymore, that God reaches out to us if we're willing to be helped by him. Doesn't mean we're going to be healed of our physical ailment, but God can help us get through the tough times. He's so willing to help as we learn to let go. I think of many people in our church here who have lived with cancer, who've recovered from terrible accidents, who have gone through maybe one or two or three marriages, who have gone through difficult times. Yet you keep on keeping on because God has touched you and has given you strength and has taught you the deep lessons of life, just like this guy that I was playing tennis with. Life is so sweet now because of what he's gone through. And that can be for our story as well. This was a story of the poor and the outcast in the New Testament. This man, when no one else could help him, Jesus came to his rescue. Sounds radical, and it is radical. But Jesus is there for us. You know, sometimes when we're just throwing our own pity parties, it's good to call a friend and complain a bit, and hopefully they'll pray for you. Words of David in Psalm 23 come to mind. "The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He makes me to lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside the still waters. He restores my soul." He brings restoration. That's so good. That's what makes the church so special. We are here not because of our own merit, but we are here because of God's merit. We limp in and hear the master say, "Take up your mat and walk," because you can do that now. Too bad we don't have more time. Maybe on Thanksgiving, the Sunday before Thanksgiving, we'll turn around, we'll pass the mic around, and people can share about how God has bring restoration to you in your own life. I know many of you quite well, and I genuinely thank God for the changes in your lives. I think of a couple who were both addicted to alcohol and drugs, and recently they just celebrated 5 years of sobriety. They're thankful for a second chance. I think of those who have had financial problems, those who have had health problems. Yet through it all, you've hung in there, and God's blessed you as you've come through it. One final thought regarding this man and the story who'd been lame for 38 years. He obviously had been by that pool for a long, long time, but he never got into the water until Jesus came. There may be some here who need to get in the water. You may need to give the Lord your life. There may be some that are joining us online who are far from God. Maybe it's time to dive in and to really give your allegiance to Christ and watch what happens. It's amazing how God can give us help. Do you believe that? Do you believe God brings restoration? He does. I'm so thankful for that. That's what our church is about. The walking wounded. You know, church is a place for people to be renewed and restored to God. We heard from Terry today. You were far from God. I remember when you walked in the doors those years, 26 years ago. God turned your life around. I thank God for that. May God help us to be willing to be open to Him and what He wants to do in our lives. Let us pray together. God, some of us have been limping around for a long, long time trying to make it on our own, and we haven't got any better. Won't you touch our lives and help us to really put our trust in you? Lord, I pray for those who are going through really difficult times now. Just surround them with your love. Bring people into their lives to give them hope. And Lord, I thank you for this time together. Thank you for your love for us. Thank you for never leaving us nor forsaking us, for always being there with us in time of need. We pray these things in the name of Jesus. And all God's people said, amen.
At this time, our ushers will collect the morning offering. And again, this week, if you would like to give, in addition to your tithe, if you would like to give to missions, those gifts will be given towards hurricane relief for Hurricane Ian. Thank you.
Thank you. us pray for the offering. God, we thank you for the many blessings that you have given us. Lord, as we give back to you and love our neighbor, may it be an act of worship. We pray that you would use the gifts this morning for the building of your kingdom. We pray all this in Jesus' name. Amen. At this time, I invite you to stand and to join together in our final hymn, What a Friend We Have in Jesus.
May the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious unto you. May the Lord lift his countenance upon you and give you his peace, both now and forever.